Yes, we'll start, sir. Good morning, all. Today's topic is on congenital malformations of lung. I'll be discussing briefly on embryology of lung and three conditions. One is CPAM, prenatal diagnosis and management, postnatal diagnosis and management, pulmonary sequestration, congenital lobar emphysema, and a small slide on our hospital experience. This is an interesting case report which I saw, which I wanted to share. It's a case report of a giant congenital CPAM, which was resected on ECMO. A primary gravida mother present on an anomaly scan at 18 weeks was discovered to have a fetus with a giant thoracic CPAM. The CVR, the cyst volume ratio, was 2.03, which is very high risk for high drops. So due to signs of high drops, she underwent thoracocentesis. It was performed at 20 plus 6 weeks, and after that CVR decreased to 0.5. 1 week later, on ultrasound, CVR again increased to 1.36, in addition to skin edema and ascites. So this fetus required multiple series of shunts during the course of gestation. CVR reached up to a maximum of 4.96 at 36 plus 4 weeks. In between this period, during the prenatal course, there was further, the pregnancy was further complicated by premature rupture of membranes at 30 plus 3 weeks, which was treated with antibiotics and bed rest. So she also received courses of beclomethasone on multiple occasions. The infant later was delivered by LSES at 36 plus 5 weeks. The child was, after delivery, the child had respiratory distress and hence was intubated and transferred to NICU and required high ventilatory support. Later was placed on ECMO. On day 2 of ECMO, the child underwent right lower lobectomy with the operating time of about 69 minutes and blood loss of about 50 ml. The ECMO run was uncomplicated and it was stopped on 1 minute, sir. The ECMO run was uncomplicated. It was stopped on day 8. The child was maintained in on oscillatory ventilation, and ventilator wean was accomplished over 15 days, and the child was discharged after 1 month of admission into the hospital. On post-operative follow-up, child was found to be having difficulty in feeding due to tiring with oral intake and significant GERD. So Nissen's fund application with gastrostomy tube placement was performed when the child was 71 days old. Now, later she continued to thrive well and met all her developmental milestones. So before we go into CPAM, we'll discuss about the embryology of lung. Embryology of lung can be divided into various stages. The first one is the embryonic stage, which begins at 4 weeks. So initially, we all know that lung development happens from the cranial end of the foregut. Initially, there is laryngotracheal diverticulum which is formed. And then later gradually increases in size, and there is a tracheoesophageal fold and it forms a septum, and then the tube separates, two tubes are formed. So this happens, this takes about 4 to 7 weeks, and a primary bronchi is also formed during this stage. Later, the next stage is called the pseudoglandular stage, which is which happens between 5 to 17 weeks, in which multiple bronchioles, like multiple bronchi, are formed. At the same time, on the other side, on one side there is this bronchial formation and then tracheal bronchial formation. The other side, which happens because of the endoderm from the foregut. On the other side, all these arteries and capillaries are derived from the splanchnopleuric mesoderm. So this also happens simultaneously. During the pseudoglandular stage, there is bronchioles that are formed and conducting epithelium are formed. And the next is the canalicular stage, which happens between the 16 to 26 weeks. And during this stage, multiple bronchioles and terminal bronchioles till the end of the bronchioles are formed. So, and also these pneumatocytes, the type 1 pneumatocytes and type 1 pneumocytes and type 2 pneumocytes are formed. And this, towards the end of canalicular stage, there is surfactant formation. And more surfactants are seen, especially in the amniotic fluid, is seen in the saccular stage. Here, these alveolar ducts are formed. That is why this saccular stage is between from 24 weeks till the term. So we want every child to attain term before pregnancy. So that is which is what improves the lung functioning. Last is the alveolarization stage, which happens after 36 weeks to up to about 21 years. So based on this staging, wherever there is an abnormality, then what congenital anomalies can be formed. So if there is an abnormality at the pseudoglandular stage, then there can be pulmonary agenesis or lobar agenesis. Towards the end of pseudoglandular stage, we can have CPAMs, which are type 1, 2, 3, or a bronchopulmonary sequestration, or congenital high airway obstruction syndrome. And in the saccular stage, there can be pulmonary hypoplasia. So, for example, like other diseases like PUV and all those, or congenital diaphragmatic hernia, if when there is an indication for fetal intervention, if we can do something during that period, we can avoid pulmonary hypoplasia because it happens at the later stage. Postnatal development, which is the alveolarization stage, so it consists of three stages. Stage one is between from birth to 1 to 2 years with alveolar proliferation and rapid increase in the alveolar number. Stage two is from 2 to 3 years with the microvascular maturation and proliferation. Stage three is from 2 to 8 years with the late alveolarization and alveolar maturity. So if we do lobectomy, what are the mechanisms of lung growth? One is the compensatory alveolar multiplication, which is what we all want the child to have, or the overinflation of the remaining parenchyma. Mainly this alveolar multiplication occurs after lobectomy in patients younger than 1 year. So congenital cystic adenomatoid malformation per se. CCAM or CPAM are hematomatous lesion composed of both cystic and adenomatous overgrowth of terminal bronchioles. It's a rare developmental anomaly of the lower respiratory tract with the incidence of about 1:8,000 to 1:35,000. The cystic intrapulmonary mass communicates with the airway but does not participate in gas exchange and may cause infection, mediastinal shift and cardiac compression and result in pulmonary hypoplasia of the remaining tissue. Earlier it was called CCAM, now it is changed to CPAM because the initial diagnosis we got to know because of the cystic nature of the disease. But later, as we got to know about the pathogenesis, few of them are not cystic in nature. So it is changed, the name is changed to congenital pulmonary airway malformation. The part of the lung which is involved with CPAM, the lung anatomy or histology is like this. It is they have polypoid projections of the mucosa, increase in smooth muscle and elastic tissue within the cyst walls, absence of cartilage in cystic parenchyma, presence of mucus secreting cells, absence of inflammation. They can present as recurrent respiratory infections, dyspnea, hemoptysis, hemothorax, empyema, pneumothorax, or sometimes rarely malignant transformation. There are various classifications of CPAM. The most common one, the mostly followed one, is the Stockhausen classification. So they are divided into five types, type 0 to type 4. Type 0 is the lethal one. The types are divided in such a way it as per the development. If it is happening at the tracheal and bronchial level, if it is happening at the beginning of the pseudoglandular stage, then it is type 0. Then after few days, after few weeks, then it is type 1, then later type 2 and type 3, type 4. So if it is tracheal or bronchial, then it is type 0. They are generally lethal. They account for about less than 2%, and all lobes of the lung are involved. Type 1 are the most common one. They account for about 60 to 65%, and their developmental origin is from the bronchial or bronchiolar level. They generally are asymptomatic or sometimes present with delayed respiratory distress. The cyst size is about from about 0.5 centimeters to 10 centimeters. They are generally lobar. The involvement is generally lobar. And these type 1 lesions are known to be associated with bronchoalveolar carcinoma. Type 2 lesions are the next most common ones. They account for about 15 to 20%. And timing of presentation generally postnatal. Clinical presentation again is respiratory presentation, often associated, sometimes like they can be associated with pneumothorax and all that. The size, cyst size is from 0.5 centimeters to 2 centimeters. Again, these are lobar involvement of the lung, but they are more associated with congenital anomalies like cardiovascular, CDH, bronchopulmonary sequestration. Type 3 are the solid ones. So their developmental origin is again bronchiolar or alveolar. They account for about 5 to 10%. And clinical presentation, again, they can be prenatal causing high drops, and postnatal again presenting with respiratory distress because of the mass, size of the mass. Cysts, they're all microcysts, very small cysts, less than 0.5 centimeters. They can involve the entire lung or a particular lobe. Type 4 or the acinar type, they account for about 10%. They can be, clinical presentation can be incidental, sometimes just as a pneumothorax. They're type 4, if it is acinar, that means they're in the periphery. So they can present as a large lung cyst, especially like a bullet. They are associated with pleuropulmonary blastoma. Antenatal diagnosis of CPAM is generally by ultrasound.
Vinay?
Yes, sir?
Can you go back to the previous slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, your presentation is brilliant. So far, it is very interesting. And you put different types. We understand this is more a pathological classification. But what I'm asking is, how can you make it clinically? How do you diagnose between the four types, and what is its clinical implications?
Yes, sir. I have a slide on the CT of, I mean, when they present, as in the CT findings of each of them, sir. I'll be just sharing it later, sir.
Okay, done. Go ahead.
Antenatal diagnosis. CPAMs appear as hyperechoic, heterogeneous tissue with multiple hypoechoic cysts that may differ in size and number. Sometimes there can be confusion about CPAM and sequestration antenatally. In such cases, we can use color Doppler to differentiate between CPAM and sequestration. So the first one shows a CCAM and the second one shows a sequestration because there is an artery which is arising from the aorta. Physiology of any congenital lung lesions, most of them, about, I mean, few of them, about 20% of them undergo regression, and some of them do cause problems. For example, if they cause compression, then they can cause, if they cause compression of the esophagus, they can cause polyhydramnios. If they cause compression of the lung, there can be lung hypoplasia, and inferior vena cava, if they compress, then it can cause high drops and mortality. So prenatal diagnosis, lesions actually depend on the presence or absence of high drops. The seriousness depends on the presence or absence of high drops, size of the lesion and its secondary effect like mediastinal shift, the extent of pulmonary hypoplasia, polyhydramnios, cardiovascular compromise, degree of development of unaffected lung, presence or absence of other congenital anomalies. Generally, in prenatal diagnosis, they are divided into only microcysts or macrocysts. Microcysts are cysts less than more than 5.5 centimeters, and macrocysts are more than 0.5 centimeters. Microcysts are solid echogenic masses. The overall prognosis depends on the size rather than the type of the cyst. This what we call CVR or CPAM volume ratio was put forth by Cromwell Holm in his paper in March 2002. It says the volume of the cyst to the head circumference. Volume of the cyst is derived by 0.52 into length, height and width of the cyst divided by the head circumference. Generally, if it is less than 1, then they are known to be asymptomatic. But if they are more than 1.2, then they are known to be symptomatic. However, more than 1.6, then they are known to be associated with high drops in more than 75% of patients. So how do we follow up these patients? If the CVR is 1.6, then the risk of high drops is high. So follow up ultrasound to be done twice weekly. There is no proper designed protocol for this, but this is what most of them follow in the US. If the CVR is 1.2 to 1.6, then twice a week ultrasound is done, followed by if the cyst progression, cyst is not increasing in size, then it is done weekly. If the CVR is less than 1.2, then it is done only weekly initially, followed by once in 2 weeks. MRI also is useful. Most of the times ultrasound should be enough, but MRI is useful when ultrasound findings are equivocal or images are difficult to interpret, such as in late pregnancy or with inaccessible fetal position. Depending on the type of the lesion, MRI can show a homogeneous or heterogeneous T2 hyperintense lesion containing cystic spaces and vascular architectural distortion. This is a picture of MRI of the same child with who has undergone fetal thoracocentesis. This is before thoracocentesis, the other one is after thoracocentesis. The general algorithm of prenatal management of CPAM: when we suspect the CPAM, we get an ultrasound. I mean, generally antenatal ultrasound is done. So if we find out any associated anomalies or chromosomal anomalies, then we counsel the parents and expectant management of the pregnancy is done. If the CPAM is high risk, that is CVR is more than 1.6, or regardless of the CVR, if the child has high drops, then if the gestational age is more than 32 weeks, it is advised for an early delivery or an exit procedure, ex utero, intrauterine treatment procedure, or else if the gestational age is less than 32 weeks, then it is preferred to give maternal steroids. And if the cysts are macrocystic, and if we can aspirate them, it's better to do either thoracocentesis or fetal thoracoamniotic shunting. If the evolution is good, then we can do a close follow-up with serial ultrasound. But if there is bad evolution, then it is better to consider fetal surgery. And if the cysts are small, if it is microcystic, and on maternal steroids, if there is no improvement, then it is better to undergo maternal fetal surgery. Or if there is improvement in CVR on steroids, then again close follow-up with ultrasound is preferred. Later, when the child attains term, it is delivery is planned. So postnatal diagnosis, these are the different ways that different types of CPAMs present. Postnatal most acceptable imaging techniques, we can do X-ray, ultrasound, and all that. X-ray might show some subtle changes, or ultrasound, as it is a lesion which contains air, so it might not be much useful postnatally. So the most preferred technique or method of choice is the CT scan. There is no established protocol on the frequency of the CT that has to be done. But generally, people say in an asymptomatic child, it is better to do after 3 months. So the benefit of repeat CT needs to be balanced against the risk of ionizing radiation. In this type 1, it is the size of the cyst is most, it will be generally a single solitary or a few big cysts, generally more than 0.5 centimeters, close to about like 5 centimeters, 8 centimeters, like that. Type 2 is like multiple small cysts, less than 2 centimeters or more than 0.5 centimeters. Type 3 is a solid cyst. I'm sorry, in this it looks like one big cyst, but actually if you scroll, there was a video, I didn't get the video. If you scroll down, it is like a solid lesion with hyper lucent areas. That's what it looks like. And the type 4 one is like a bullet. We can see, we can make out a difference between the type 1 and type 2 here. Type 1 is like well encapsulated ones. Type 4 are like very thin, they are located in the periphery. Even if they are big, they are like about to rupture sort of a thing. They present more like more with pneumothorax. That is how, those are the subtle differences, but most likely the management will be same for each of them.
Vinay?
Yes, sir?
Go back to the previous slide. Yes. This slide, very, very crucial. I think it is worth re-emphasizing so that it is registered by everybody. Just re-present the same slide. You presented very well. Tell it again. The different types.
Yes, sir. So the type one is mainly involves the bronchial or the bronchiolar malformation, and that's why the cysts generally are large in size. They are more than 0.5 centimeters and close to about 10 centimeters. And they're centrally located. They can be located centrally, and if it is very large in size, they can come up to the periphery. But they are mainly located in the periphery, in the center. And type 2 lesions, they are generally the size, they are multiple, and the sizes are from 0.5 to 2 centimeters. They're generally less than 2 centimeters, but they involve one particular lobe as such. They don't involve the entire. Type 3 is a solid lesion. There are no proper like cysts that is formed. We can make out difference on CT based on the hyperlucency and solid structures that is there on CT. And type 4 lesions are alveolar in nature. They are located in the periphery. They are no way in close contact with the bronchus. However, and also even if the, however, they can grow as much as about 10 centimeters like a type 1 cyst. But they are very thin, very flimsy. They are about to rupture. They're more like a bullet. So we'll go to the next slide. Postnatal management of CPAM. So every CPAM patient must be evaluated for surgery. But whether to operate or not, it's a divided opinion. Some people prefer surgery. Some people prefer wait and watch if the patient is asymptomatic. Obviously, surgical treatment is recommended if the patient is symptomatic. And newborns with large lesions may require a neonatal surgical resection in order to save the viable lung parenchyma and reverse mediastinal displacement. However, there is no consensus has yet been reached regarding the optimal timing of surgery in asymptomatic patients. Proponents of early and elective lobectomy say that these are the advantages. An early lobectomy avoids long periods of observation, preventing the need for using ionizing radiation in repeated imaging studies and the loss of patients during follow-up. And sometimes, if no imaging technique is able to confirm the pathological diagnosis, so when the diagnosis is uncertain, it is better to undergo, the earlier the intervention, the better. And the possible relation of CPAM with lung malignancy development is also one risk. And potential, if we do it early, then potential compensatory lung growth is an advantage. However, if some patients, physicians prefer surgery in a symptomatic patient, they wait till the patient develops symptoms and then undergoes and then do a surgery, then what are the complications? One is it creates longer hospital stay, and then longer pleural drainage and ventilation, higher rate of post-operative complications like fistula, hemorrhage, secondary surgery. However, there is no difference in the mortality. Now, if we operate, what are the surgical considerations? Thoracoscopy or thoracotomy? Obviously, we know thoracoscopy is minimally invasive, so the advantages of short term is very good. I mean, we all know that. But in the long term, there is no difference regarding the overall complications and surgical duration. That is why in an expert hand, thoracoscopy is equally good. Whether the child should undergo lobectomy or parenchymal sparing resection. On the table, it is very difficult to find out the limit between CPAM and normal parenchyma. So it is preferred to do a lobectomy. And lobectomy is recommended to avoid recurrent pulmonary infection and neoplasia. However, in case of very loculated, like very segmental CPAM, and when we are very sure that not much of the lung parenchyma is involved, then we can do a segmentectomy. Some people do prefer that. And also in case of bilateral lung lesions, we might have to go for parenchymal sparing resections. This we discussed in our last class on thoracic tumors, congenital pulmonary malformation versus lung tumors. The incidence is about 2%. And the lung tumor most often associated with CPAM, the congenital pulmonary malformations, is pulmonary blastoma, pulmonary sarcoma, embryonal sarcoma, pulmonary rhabdomyosarcoma, embryonal RMS, malignant mesenchymoma, adenocarcinoma, and bronchoalveolar carcinoma occurs in adults. This is an article I shared last time also. Association between congenital lung malformations and lung tumors in children and adults, a systematic review. In that, they say all these pulmonary malformations children must be followed up closely as they may conceal a tumor. So it is recommended to excise the asymptomatic lesions as late complications outweigh the acceptable morbidity of resection. So this is the algorithm of postnatal management of CPAM. When the child presents at the neonatal period, if the child is asymptomatic, we'll do an X-ray. But if the child is asymptomatic, we prefer CT scan at 3 months of age. That's when we can think of resection. If it is unilobar or unilateral, then thoracoscopic lobectomy, if we have the expertise, can be done. If it is bilobar or bilateral, then it is preferred for a parenchymal sparing resection. If the child is symptomatic and is having a major respiratory distress, we should do the cardiorespiratory stabilization is essential. After that, we'll do a CT and 2D echo, then prefer for open surgery after stabilization. If the respiratory distress is minimal, as is the case most commonly, then we do a CT and 2D echo. Then we can either do a thoracoscopic or open lobectomy. Now, pulmonary sequestration. This is one of the cases operated in our hospital recently during the lockdown. A 20 days old female neonate born by LSCS at WIMS Bellary was antenatally detected to have a left-sided congenital lesion, congenital pulmonary sequestration. After delivery, the child had respiratory distress, however was maintaining normal oxygen saturation, hence the child was referred here for further management. CCT was suggestive of left lower lobe sequestration with a large feeder vessel from the aorta going to the mass. The child underwent a left thoracotomy and sequestrectomy. Thoracoscopy could have been done, but due to the COVID situation, the thoracoscopy was not available, so we did a thoracotomy. And the postoperative drain was removed on day 1 and discharged on day 3. So pulmonary sequestration is a non-functioning mass of lung tissue that lacks normal communication with the tracheobronchial tree, which reverses an arterial blood supply from the systemic circulation. It can be divided into intralobar sequestration, extralobar sequestration, and one rare entity of bronchopulmonary foregut malformation. Intralobar sequestration means the lesion that lies within the normal lobe and lacks a separate visceral pleura. Extralobar sequestration, the mass is located outside the normal lung, invested in a separate visceral pleura. Bronchopulmonary foregut malformation is an abnormal lung attached to the GI tract. Sometimes there can be a bronchus arising from the esophagus also. This can be a bronchopulmonary foregut malformation. These sequestrations, most common location is the left lower lobe, is between the left lower lobe and the diaphragm, which is about 80%. And 13% of cases, it is located below the diaphragm also. These sequestrations are associated with other congenital anomalies like CDH, vertebral anomalies, congenital heart disease, pulmonary hypoplasia, colonic duplication. Majority of the intralobar sequestration have no communication to the bronchial tree. However, even if there is some connection, it is abnormal and does not permit a normal gas exchange. But bacteria can enter through it and cause infection. So they are known to have high infection. Sometimes they present as pneumonia. Sometimes they present as empyema. And we have got patients where it is thought as empyema, then decortication is done and then referred saying there is some residual mass. So for which we had to resect. So we know the vascular supply generally arises from the lower thoracic or upper abdominal aorta. Mostly they have a single arterial feeder. However, few may have multiple vessels. Again, presentation is they can be detected antenatally, and 75% of them are asymptomatic. However, 25% of the children can be symptomatic. They can have feeding difficulties or respiratory distress on feeding, recurrent pneumonia, congestive cardiac failure because of the size of the lesion. There can be hyperdynamic circulation, especially seen in older children. And they can also present as hemoptysis. In rare instances, especially in hybrid lesions, they can cause fibrous mesothelioma and carcinoma. The diagnosis can be done by plain X-ray. They often show a triangular opacity in the affected segment, and may sometimes, if it is infected, they may show cystic spaces also. CT scan, they show us a solid mass that may be homogeneous or heterogeneous, sometimes with cystic changes. Emphysematous changes can be seen at the margin of the lesion, and as I showed in our index case, the arterial supply is from the descending aorta can be seen. Ultrasonography antenatally, the sequestered portion of the lung is more echogenic than the rest of the lung. On antenatal ultrasound, an extralobar sequestration may be seen as early as about 16 weeks of gestation and typically appears as a solid, well-defined triangular echogenic mass. Color Doppler may identify a feeding vessel from the aorta. If the sequestration is subdiaphragmatic, it may appear as an echogenic intra-abdominal mass. So the treatment, general consensus is sequestration has to be resected. However, there are few papers which suggest that in case of extralobar sequestration, where there is definite no communication with the bronchus, they can be observed. However, the general dictum is sequestration should be resected. Or in some cases where resection is not feasible, then it is embolization of the systemic feeding vessels can be done as an alternative to surgical resection. Extralobar sequestration, the excision is relatively straightforward and thoracoscopic approach is preferable. Challenge is mainly to identify the systemic vessel. Intralobar sequestration, formal lobectomy is required. For subdiaphragmatic extralobar sequestration, laparoscopy or laparotomy approach can be performed. One rare anomaly which is associated with the pulmonary sequestration is the Scimitar syndrome. It is right-sided pulmonary hypoplasia, pulmonary sequestration, and partial anomalous pulmonary venous drainage of the right lung, usually to the inferior vena cava. Now, congenital lobar emphysema. This is one case report which I came across, which I wanted to share. It's a 22-day-old male neonate, which was referred with history of respiratory distress since 1 week. No history of cyanosis, jaundice, convulsion, and signs of heart failure. Antenatal scans were normal. Baby was being breastfed. On chest X-ray, marked over-distension of the left upper lobe was seen with right-sided mediastinal shift. CT showed hyperlucent, hyperextended lobe with midline substantial herniation and compression of the remaining lung. The child was managed conservatively. So basically, they published this article, they published this case report to emphasize that congenital lobar emphysema does not mean we have to operate always. They can be managed conservatively. However, they require a closer follow-up. So congenital, the frequency of CLE are 1 is to 2 lakhs or 1 is to 3 lakh. The most common location is left upper lobe in about 40 to 50%, right upper lobe about 20%, right middle lobe about 20%. And male to female ratio is 3 is to 1. The pathogenesis involved in CLE are obstruction of the developing airway, which causes a check valve type of obstruction. So the causes are congenital can be bronchial atresia, stenosis, diffuse bronchomalacia, bronchiectasia, and abnormal bronchial takeoffs. Acquired can be meconium plux, foreign bodies, granulation tissue, torsion of the bronchus. Extensive can be pulmonary artery sling, along anomalous venous return or forget cyst or teratoma. The clinical features can be severity and time of onset of symptoms, varies depending on the degree of parenchymal distension. Infants primarily present with tachypnea become cyanotic, and episodes may be exacerbated by feeding or crying. If we do a ventilator perfusion scan, they may show relatively nearly absent perfusion at the affected lobe. So diagnosis, as we discussed in the previous slides, is by X-ray and ultrasound. There is over-distension of the affected lobe with asymmetry and parenchymal transparency with hyperlucent zone. So this is what is seen in CT also. The treatment, as I said, this CLE is one of the rare situations where respiratory distress can be very severe. And sometimes people mistake it for pneumothorax and insert an ICD, which should not be done. And still the child will not be, will still have respiratory compromise. In such cases, they might require an ICU, I mean ICU bedside thoracotomy. At the same time, if children are not severely, not in that kind of a respiratory distress, they can be managed conservatively also. If we do a surgery, then it is lobectomy. Our hospital experience on these congenital malformations are, we have done, from the period of 2014 to 2018, we have done about 20 lobectomies, out of which 11 for CLE, 7 for CPAM, 2 for sequestration. Thoracoscopic lobectomies have been 3 and 1 has got converted. Thoracotomy has been 17. And we are now doing we are planning to do a study on the long-term outcome of these children with lobectomies by doing a pulmonary function test to see how their long-term outcome is. But due to COVID situation, the pulmonary function tests are closed now. So as it restarts, then we'll go ahead with the study, and then we'll let you know the results. Thank you, sir.
Vinay.
Yes.
Vinay, it was a very good presentation. So congratulations. Very detailed and very nice presentation.
Thank you.